the South came along, and I would have died to get it. You know, it was just one of those roles of a lifetime.
This is Gone with the Wind for the last half of the 20th century. This is Gone with the Wind for television.
I didn't have to create Madeline. John Jakes created Madeline.
The popularity of the American Civil War and all that goes with it really lies in the emotion of people who are close to one another being torn apart by what they believe or what they're supposed to believe.
Roots was a story of the South from the black point of view. North and South is the story of the South from the white point of view.
The very first thing that you hear when the project goes on is the main title, and that's the music. And the music is going to carry that message of what is this thing all about?
Come on, girl.
Well, North and South, the trilogy, began with a three-book contract that I had. Originally, it was to be three books about a military family through the years, one family. I then started to research it, and of course, the first place I went to was West Point. Read the history of West Point, and in one book I came across this one page that named all of the generals who fought each other in the Civil War on opposite sides. They had all known each other at West Point. They had gone to school together. They had gone to Mexico together, fought there. And I called up my editor and I said, Julian, this has got to be it. Now, we're going to do two families at West Point, and it divides very nicely into North and South dealing with the antebellum years, love and war dealing with the war itself, heaven and hell dealing with Reconstruction. And that was it. But it was an evolution.
Well, the North and South came about because I actually got a call from ABC. They just bought a book called North and South. I had just done Roots, and I had just done the Thornburys for them, so they said, we couldn't think of anybody better. We'd like to turn over the whole project, but to you. So I read the book, the first book, right away, and I said, it's a great, juicy story. John Jakes is a very juicy writer.
It was material that would be, it could be adapted so well for the form, the long form. In which feature films can't do because they're compressed into an hour and a half or 2 hours. And this story needed a lot of time to be told effectively and to be told the right way.
I knew I had to do a formidable amount of research for the trilogy. First of all, because the Civil War is such an enormously popular subject, not only in the United States, but around the world. Today, the Civil War is called sometimes the Brothers' War, the Cousins' War, and phrases like that really exemplify the split, the painful split that took part in our country.
You know, years ago, John Calhoun said that West Point men would lead great armies. He never thought they'd be leading them against each other.
And I hadn't really realized it was that deep or that harrowing. But that was the whole point that emerged in writing North and South, was these two guys, basically, who had a great affection for one another as West Point classmates. At the end, when war broke out, they were pulled apart. They each had to go their own way, and it was more than just a casual decision. It was very, very emotional.
I tell you, we didn't have any problems with the theme, with any controversy with the North and South for one particular reason. You heard the South's point of view, and you heard the North's point of view. So it wasn't, you heard slavery, but then you heard the people in the North say how bad it was.
I was really intrigued with this time period because at the same time as it was a coming of age story, in many ways for Ori and George, it was a coming of age period in my life as Patrick, you know, having to really analyze and look at who I am and what I was about and who I thought I was as opposed to who I really was.
Television definitely has its place, and North and South definitely had its place. Telling the story of certain aspects of slavery, seen from a white man's perspective. I think it did marvelous things with Virgilia's character, you know, the abolitionist and all of that.
Reading John Jakes's books gave me great insight, but it also prodded me to do a lot more research and also delve into my own family tree, some who died and some who spent time in Confederate prison camps and so forth. So that really brought it very close to me.
The only thing I determined before I started writing North and South was that I would not be an apologist for slavery under any circumstances. I have actually been cornered at parties by what I call professional Southerners who try to tell me that slavery wasn't so bad. It was okay. That they were wage slaves in the North. They were slaves in the factories. And to that, I always say, yes, but in the North, they could walk away. They could just walk away.
I had no idea what I was getting into because I am a Southern man. I do come from a belief system that is based in integrity and morality and a certain code. This time period with the Civil War brewing, and in many ways, it was the first time men were challenged to start questioning this code.
I was living in South Carolina, recently moved in at the time I started the book. I located their plantation up near Charleston. I debated as to whether to put the main family in the cotton business or the rice business. Ultimately, I decided on the rice business because that was older than the cotton business in South Carolina. I would say the main family were middle-of-the-road Southerners in the sense that they were slave owners, but tried not to mistreat their slaves. But when push came to shove, they were willing to apply horrible punishments to the slaves.
Oh, Mr. Main, sir.
What's Prime done? Why are you beating him?
No crime exactly. It's his attitude, sir. Prime don't show the proper respect.
A good overseer knows how to get a man's respect without beating him. And we don't whip slaves at Mont Royal.
It really taught me what it is to be a true Southern man. You know, it was like at one point my agent had a meeting with me and said, "You've got to quit calling everybody sir." And I went, "Why?" He says, "Because it shows a lack of respect for yourself." And I went, "What the hell is wrong with you? I mean, that's insanity." It had nothing to do with my self-esteem. It had to do with, you know, the certain way you're brought up. You hold the door for women. You pull their chair out. It's your job. It's not a macho thing. But also, when you say sir in a different context, it can also be very dangerous. You know, sir, you mess with me one more time, and I break every bone in your body.
Let's have you, Mr. Main.
At your service, sir.
Two personalities. We picked James Reed, and we had auditions and readings and everything. And James Reed looked the right to us, you know. We wanted attractive-looking guy, actors, obviously. Patrick Swayze was not a big star at the time, and he looked perfect for us too. Both of them auditioned and read and screen tested, and they got the part because they came out the best in the screen test in the audition.
Damon Wahlberg and I didn't have many arguments, but we had one about Ori losing his arm. You know, in the book, he loses an arm fighting in Mexico. Consequently, his other arm is extremely powerful and can even be used as a weapon. Well, David didn't want to do that. And I can remember we argued about it on the phone, and he finally persuaded me by saying, "Look," he said, if I have to have 12 hours or 10 hours or 8 hours or whatever with Patrick Swayze with his arm tied behind his back, they won't get the story. They'll be saying, "Where's his arm hiding? Where's his arm hiding?" So I said, "All right, you've won.
Patrick has such charisma that every girl who met, and I'm sure meets him today, you meet him and you go, oh, and he lights something up inside you. So it wasn't difficult to act that, because even though I didn't, you know, want to sort of leap off into the sunset with him, he's a charismatic person, and he inspires those looks and that flirtatiousness.
I don't even know your name.
It's Ari. Ari Main. I'm from Mont Royal, just up the river.
Well, my name is Madeline Fabre.
I'm delighted to meet you.
I've always said, you give me horses, capes, and cleavage, and I'm a happy man. You know. I still have the wardrobe, but I've never let go of my general's uniform and the cape. When Madeline and I make love for the first time in that burned-out church, and sort of consummate this doomed, or looks like it's doomed, relationship. It was a really emotional time for me because my dad died. My real dad died soon before. So when you asked me earlier about, you know, how does it feel to, you know, with your father dying and as Ori and having to take over the family and that responsibility and carry on the legacy, I was in the throes, personally, in the throes of, what do I do without my dad?
The North was so overwhelmingly powerful as an industrial concern, as an industrial society, that it seemed to me that having the hazards in the iron business, making cannon, making whatever they made during the war, was probably a good way to exemplify the strength of the North.
I think that my character, George Hazard, was the conscience of the story. He, the moral conscience, the moral authority. He had a true understanding of the division that was apparently ripping the country apart. It wasn't black and white. It wasn't the South is bad, the North is good. It's more complicated than that.
There was not a guy on North and South that I didn't at one point or another think, so darling, just so darling, let me just hug you and kiss you. And James Reed is certainly one of them. And of course, I did get to hug him and kiss him in North and South 3. A marvelous actor. He really is.
I try to bring the sense of me that meets up with the character. And George's journey is one that goes from optimistic youth looking to the promise of the future to one that grows into disillusionment and pain and the suffering that goes with fighting for a cause that you believe in but carries with it a tremendous price.
I fell in love with him as a person and his ease, his James Bond kind of, you know, handsome and cool. And in many ways, I wanted to be him because he was just so cool and just had so much class. And, you know, and I'm like the reactionary, you know, if it moves, eat it.
He was great in this series. He really was. He had a tough uphill battle with that part, you know, North, upper class, he didn't have any of the raw emotion that Ori Main had. He had an uphill battle and he pulled it off really well.
Well, George was sort of the steady one in the family. Physically, George and Ori in the pictures are reversed. Ori was tall and thin, skinny, kind of a Lincoln-esque figure. George was short, stocky. That changed when the actors were cast.
My brother obviously forgot to introduce me, Mr. May.
Of course not.
I'm Virgilia Hazard.
Virgilia who has always been one of my favorite characters. She was a fiery abolitionist.
So where, ladies and gentlemen, do these new slaves come from? Why, they come from slavery itself. For the true crop of a southern plantation is a human crop.
I don't have to tell you about Kirstie Alley. The audience know how feisty she is.
Kirstie's intense. I mean, just she's got that fire in her eyes. She gets on something, she's like a pit bull. As actors, we played an underlying current of attraction, you know, to where it was that kind of, you know, dangerous male-female relationship.
Well, since you're so enamored with women and their ideas, perhaps you would enjoy listening to one who actually has some.
Very easy to believe, very easy to see the passion of that character come alive in her.
Taking you into South Carolina is like taking a torch into a powder magazine.
I'll be good as gold, I promise.
To you, madam, your love of beauty is exceeded only by your love of money.
Oh, how true.
Now, somebody like Elizabeth Taylor, she agreed to do magazine, and newspaper, and radio and television interviews. So she came down to Charleston, because she hadn't done an interview for about 5 years. So what she brought us for that one day was a network television show on three network, major stories, but AP and UP, major stories in People, Time magazine, and so it's worth paying her.
I have some rather distressing news, Madeline. I know that you've probably told Ori, and no doubt he said that our family...
What is between Ori and me is none of your business, Ashton.
Well, they were all feisty, I gotta tell you. They became Kirstie Alley, Terry Garber, Wendy Kilburn. Those three became very close on the set.
I declare, I wish I could go out exactly like this.
The clothes. The clothes were a nightmare for me, I know. In the days when people actually wore those clothes, those women had them on for maybe 2 hours a day. We had them on for 12, 14, sometimes longer a day. Most of the women stopped getting our periods, completely stopped, because the pulling in of all of your organs just seizes you up. And at lunchtime, we would get to take our corsets off. And literally, they would hang them up outside the trailer and they would just drip with the sweat. And then you put them back on.
Lesley-Ann Down is a beautiful, beautiful woman. I had done two films with her, so I know how beautiful she is. I've always found her, no matter what angle you film Lesley-Ann Down from, she's beautiful.
There wasn't even a question as to what part I wanted to play. I mean, on page two, it was obvious to me that Madeline was your absolute archetypal heroine. She was the woman that would be remembered. Not that her part was more important than anybody else's, but she just definitive. She was just beautifully written, and she was one of those girls that the guys just want to get on a big old horse and go rescue. They want to be Ori Maine.
Lesley and I both were of the belief that it's not about jumping somebody's bones or sucking face that's sexy. It's about the need and the passion and the desire and the connection between two human beings in their eyes.
Well, you know what? Passionate love scenes I have some experience with. So whenever you have to act those, it just, you know, tickles the old war emotions again. So you can't, you go, oh yeah, I remember that.
Lesley-Ann Downs, the essence of a true Southern belle.
She was eye candy. She was just, you know, luscious. The scope of the production was staggering. I mean, the size and the reenacting Civil War battles and going back to this time period. But we were shooting in the places that all happened. Boone Hall, this gorgeous plantation, and standing on, you know, in between those columns and looking out, how could you not be this guy? You know, and going down the streets of Charleston in carriages, all you had to do is leave yourself open, and the production value would take you away.
The first time that we were at Boone Hall, you turn a corner and you see the canopy of trees like a cathedral stretched out in front of you. And there is the house that is so famous. It's goosebumpy.
It took us a year and a half. We filmed it in Charleston, South Carolina, and somewhere in Mississippi, and some here out in the Simi Valley. Newhall, California. We had a lot of problems. I think one of the funniest ones that happened to us is we shot in Charleston, because Charleston is a city that looks the same. Whole areas of Charleston are no different than they were back in the 1800s. So on one particular street, whenever we filmed, we had to put dirt over the pavement because there wasn't any pavement in that period. So one street, we put dirt up and down the pavement, and a woman come out screaming and yelling, "You're gonna ruin my house, you're putting dirt in my house. It's an 1860 house. All this filth and dirt's gonna ruin my house." And I looked and I said, "Woman, lady, there was dirt in front of your house for 100 years before I came. It's lasted today, it's gonna last one more day of dirt." And she looked at me and said, "Well, you're right, Mr. Walpe, you're right."
We were shooting outside of Natchez, Mississippi. And I don't know if you've ever been in Natchez in July, but it's a little hot.
We're shooting in sweltering southern heat with 150% humidity.
And of course, we're shooting a winter scene. It's snowing.
And while on camera, I would be able to turn my sweat off, but then here and there, I would just turn or lean over or whatever, or in a fight sequence or whatever, and just pass out and just hit the ground. It's like, Swayze's on the ground again, slap him, get him up.
And it was so hot that the soap flakes they used to imitate snow were melting and dripping on the costumes. Didn't lend the necessary air of authenticity they were looking for.
Major thing, of course, with the Civil War, but the battle scene. Well, fortunately, in the Civil War, there are groups in the South who meet every week and restage battles, live like the people did in those days. They live in the tents, they spend overnight together, they restage the battles together. Without them, it would be nearly impossible. It would take you months to get the costume, figure out how to stage the battles. So they really are a terrific help with people who do Civil War film. These group of Civil War experts are just sensational.
If that kind of dedication to authenticity didn't inspire you and lead you to believe that people were really dedicated to telling the story in a true and accurate way, then nothing else would.
They need no direction. They action, and they just, it's hard to stop them. No, stop killing each other. The camera's not rolling anymore.
I know that a book is not going to jump fully blown onto the screen, and I was very happy, generally, with the adaptations that came out of these novels.
You got a lot of writers who say, "Well, why don't you put this in? You changed my book, you did this." John Jakes was nothing like that. He loved what we had done in the script. He loved everything. He loved what we left out and what we added in, and we told him the reasons why we did it. He was totally approved everything. And he was one of those writers who understand the business.
I had to sit with David Wolper, who was an elegant gentleman with a reputation as a producer unparalleled, unrivaled by anyone else. He's a special man. And I believe he said to me, after knowing what the project was about, that he wanted something like Gone with the Wind. And I probably said, "Okay." And I do remember playing it on the piano for both David and the director. And I obviously accomplished what I had set out to do, at least in the minds of David and our director. The music has the emotion stuff. Is it a big project? Is it a big picture? Is it a big miniseries? I think my opening does that. I think it delivers the goods.
You know, it either has a spark and a magic or it doesn't. And North and South had a spark and a magic.
Perfect quality and perfect sound. I mean, there's nothing, couldn't ask for more as a producer.
I casually turned to David and I said, "By the way, when do we go on the air?" He says, "In 3 weeks." Shortened my life by 6 months, I'm sure, but I began immediately. Every morning from 6 o'clock to 6 o'clock at night, I wrote music because I had a week's worth of music to start recording. And I was, for 2 weeks now, always recording at night, writing during the day.
One, two, three, four.
Wouldn't it be nice if we had, in a Wagnerian sense, a leitmotif, a little theme that you attached to various players, actors, characters, as they came in, or situations?
You know, I fell in love with you during our very first dance.
Oh, I'm in love, and you hear the love theme. Oh, here comes him, and his theme plays. So I did that. I made up a little palette of themes for everyone and some situations. I think every time we fought, I did some. Playing the theme for David at the piano the first time. I'm glad that he thought it was really good, because I'd have to go back and do another one if he didn't.
Sometimes when I watch something 10 years later and see the film, I still say to myself, I don't like that scene. It could have been something, could have been better. When Ori Main came from the South to West Point, in actuality, a number of people from the South brought their slaves with them to West Point. And we cut it out there because there's a long explanation of what happened there, and I didn't want to get into a controversy and everything. But later on, I said to myself, you know, that would have been a terrific scene. It would have said something to the other characters, people from the North, about getting a closer picture of what slavery was all about. And it would have, I think, helped the overall story. And that we didn't put in, and I'm sorry about that.
It was a very, very explosive, period of time. I think it was like a gigantic soap opera. You turn on one episode and you just get sucked in.
I got the opportunity to work with unbelievable people. I mean, Jimmy Stewart.
There, now that's the smile I remember. I could tell how much your wife cared for you, and that troubled me all the time I was holding my silence.
I got myself all prepped and primed to walk on the set with Jimmy Stewart, and walked on the set, my knees turned to butter, and I couldn't remember one word of what I was supposed to say. I felt like a little kid just standing, just in awe.
I was in New Orleans a couple of months ago, and this is almost 20 years after the show first aired, and I was walking down Bourbon Street, and a guy came up to me and stopped and looked at me and said, "General Hazard," and he saluted me. And I was just taken aback.
It's one of the things that I'm most proud of, I tell you. The North and South is one of my favorites. There's hours of music.
You mean which book do I like personally? My favorite is the middle one, Love and War, because it covers the entire Civil War, start to finish, and I think is a pretty good highlight version of the war from the southern side as well as the northern side.
There's no question. Number one was my favorite book. Of course it was.
It broke my heart that I didn't get to do this role and my dad see it.
Any place where you find the essence of Civil War, where you have one people divided on an issue, makes it a story that people can relate to, no matter where they're from or what language they speak.
It was a true, extra rich chocolate piece of life, It truly was.
What I enjoy about the results is that we're still talking about it, and we can still show the film 20 years later, and we'll still be able to show it 50 years later, because it's a story about history and will always be relevant and always be important.